Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Nall. This is the Progressive Commentary Hour. Today, part two of the War on Chiropractic. This is an original series. But before we get to chiropractic, before we get to the charges that the entire profession was an unscientific cult and that no physician in America was allowed by their own ethics rules to associate with the chiropractor, there is a backstory, and it's a cautionary tale, and I'd like to share this, because this was at the beginning of my career. I had already published probably 20 important investigative reporting articles. Ralph Nader and I were both publishing in Caveat Emptor, the publication Consumer Beware. It was America's foremost, let's say, muckraking investigative reporting journal at that time. And one day I was called by a Dr. Herbert Bailey. Bailey was a highly respected journalist, medical journalist, writing on health and medical issues. He was an establishment person. And he said he would like to tell me a story and see if I had any interest in doing anything about it. He told me the story of crebiacin. Crebiacin was an anti-cancer therapy. I was not familiar with it. But some years before, it had been very popular, and its leading proponent was a Dr. Andrew Ivey. Now, for more than a half a century, Dr. Ivey was the most cited scientist in America, meaning of all the scientific journals, his work was paramount, and so people cited it. Over 2,400 citations, that's a lot. And he also was so respected, he was vice president of a major university, University of Illinois, and he was a top person in the Association of Friendships at the American Medical Association. And the story went that two brothers, the Roverick brothers, had found a serum that they extracted from horses that prevented horses from having the kind of tumors that would otherwise kill them. And they did experiments on dogs and was able to reverse the cancers. And so they took it to Dr. Ivey to see if he'd be interested in doing a clinical study, human study. Ivey looked at their work and looked at all their photographs and writings, and he was of the opinion that this should be given an opportunity. If it worked, fine. If not, nothing lost. And at that time, I was told that a top person, the treasurer of the AMA, had met with the Durovic brothers, but only after meeting with Ivey and saying that he, this top official at the AMA, would like to purchase this therapy because he was affiliated with a company that was making anti-cancer medications. And Ivey said, I have nothing to do with this. I'm just reviewing the feasibility of doing human studies. But the product is actually, and the formulation is owned by the Durovic brothers. So he approached them, and they didn't want to sell it. That began the most interesting story in medical history that I've ever been told. And the person who had done this research was Herbert Bailey. Bailey was no fringe person. He was mainstream. His articles were syndicated all throughout the United States. And he had access to virtually everyone within Orthodox medicine. So too did Andrew Ivey. Well, it turned out that crebiacin did work and was statistically significant in the trial that was ultimately done. But that's when, in recordings that were actually made surreptitiously by the Durovic's friend, who was top person in the Argentine Navy, and he was there to try to see how legitimate were all these conversations going on, and he recorded it. And the man made it very clear, if I can't have it, nobody will have it. And he was making a threat. Well, to take away crebiacin or destroy it so nobody would touch it, he first had to destroy Andrew Ivey. Now, up to that point, no one had ever done anything in medical history like this. You take one of America's preeminent, most respected academics and physicians, and you destroy them. And that's exactly what he tried to do. By the way, Ivy was so respected that in 1946 he was asked by the American Medical Association to be the jurist on the Nuremberg War Crimes Tribunal against the Germans. So, the story was a unique story in that it showed the inner workings of the AMA. In time, there was a trial. Andrew Ivey was acquitted. The Durovics were acquitted. And when they left that, the Durovics were immediately approached and told that if they stayed in the United States, they were going to be hit with all kinds of other charges, income tax charges, etc. And they just gave up and left. End of story. Not quite. Because years later, many years later, I actually found Durovic in Germany. And he had been undercover because he said he had never... He'd come out of a German concentration camp. He was lucky to be alive. And he said he never believed that this kind of dirty down politics could exist. But then Bailey also said, don't just look at Ivy and Krebias and the Durovics. Also look at what Morris Fishbein, or Dr. Fishbein, did when he was the top person at the AMA and ran the Journal of the American Medical Association. Look what he did in promoting cigarette smoking for women. And look what he did in promoting full-page ads for things that should never have been in the journal. So he gave me a lot of information, and I did a special. At that time, it was on WMCA. And it was interesting because the day I did the special, I believe that's the day that he actually passed. But this left an indelible impression that one of the most important stories never told by the American media was the truth about America had a legitimate cancer cure. But because people within the AMA could not control it and profit from it, then nobody would, and it would be destroyed. Durovic sent me a lot of documents. We had many phone conversations. But he said he wanted nothing more to do with it because he trusted nothing within our system of medicine in the United States. He was not the first person to face the backhand of the American Medical Association. There had also been a person who had been promoting a herbal combination, the Hoxie treatment. Some say it was a complete fraud. Some say it worked. I actually spoke with a woman who ran his clinic, interviewed her, went down to Mexico and then New Mexico. And there was, I believe, some benefit to it, though not the cure that it was promoted to be. Now, I give that as background before I begin this in-depth discussion today. Why? Because today, though the American Medical Association and nine of the major medical organizations in America have been told you can no longer denigrate chiropractic, you cannot call it an unscientific cult, you cannot have a secret department of investigations in the bowels of the AMA headquarters in Chicago, whose sole purpose was to, quote, isolate and destroy chiropractic, but also all other alternative healing practices. And that also included at that time osteopathic medicine and podiatry, as well as chiropractic. When they were found guilty, when they had to settle and therefore change the whole ethics of how they did business, that was not the end of the story. If you were a chiropractor, you suddenly had a breath of fresh air. I had written four major articles exposing the AMA because I was one of two people, along with an outstanding journalist named Joe Lisa, who received secret documents out of AMA headquarters, which is probably one of the reasons they've held me in such disdain, because I wrote extensively and I rallied chiropractors. Also, they were denigrating chiropractors in the schools so chiropractors couldn't get science classes. That all ended when they could no longer be prejudiced. Insurance companies began to cover them. Now, in part one, I talked about and showed specific example from the actual trial of how the AMA selected members to go on a so-called independent review to see whether or not Medicare should cover chiropractic, and then had the determination that it shouldn't before the first person was ever brought in. It was a totally fixed fixed panel, though a couple of the members on there were adamant that they would make up their own mind and not be prejudiced, but the rest of them fell right in line. Morehouse College, many CW Post, many colleges went along with the AMA of not allowing chiropractors to study. And so once they lost that, I was given a call by Dr. Alan Pressman. And he asked me, would I meet with a Dr. Chester Stock? And I did, at New York Institute of Technology and out on Long Island. And they asked, would I create a curriculum that would be detailed enough to get full New York State accreditation to teach the first course proved and legitimate in nutrition to chiropractors? Now, I'll bet there's not a chiropractor in the audience that knows this, but every single chiropractic school teaches nutrition. They're called the mixers versus the straights that just engage in subluxation and correcting a spinal maladjustment. But the whole field of nutrition, I created that. And that's a matter of historical fact. But also helped the chiropractors fight the good fight until they won. And the battle was thought to be over. Herein is the rub. Today, what the AMA is no longer legally able to do, Wikipedia and Jimmy Wales and their skeptics have picked up the pace of condemning chiropractic along with the Dr. Stephen Barrett. Interesting, because when Jane Brody of the New York Times, when the staff of the Consumer Union and his Consumer Reports bring in Stephen Barrett, when all these federal agencies invite him in, I'm amazed that no one ever asked him, what exactly are your credentials, specific, in the fields that you are criticizing people on or making judgment on? So do you have any credentials? Well, a California court said no, he's very biased, and is not an expert. And then he began to lose lawsuits. But that hasn't stopped him to this very day of continuing to attack homeopathy and chiropractic, anything else that he disagrees with. I have no problem with him exercising his freedom of speech to like or dislike, approve or disapprove of any therapy. That is his right. What is not his right is to engage in the type of attack he has done against myself and others as if he is an authority. He is not an authority on anything that I have done or do to this day. The difference is where I allow him and anyone else who chooses to practice medicine or psychology or anything else. They're in a field. It's their right to do what they want to do. But so too is it the right of a chiropractor, a naturopath, a homeopath, a holistic dentist and nurse, a holistic nutritionist and dietitian, a holistic medical doctor to use the techniques and protocols they believe are best suited to help a patient. So, for the chiropractors, 77,000 of them, with their patients, 35 million, I suggest that you awaken, because now you're engaged in hubris and complacency, because every week more people read negative things on Wikipedia about chiropractic. They're simply not true, than probably criticisms that were shared by people against chiropractic for the first 50 years of the last century. That is some background, because I knew about the politics of the AMA. I knew how biased it was. I knew to what level they could stoop in order to stop competition, and they ultimately were stopped. They were found to be in violation of the Sherman Antitrust Act and restraint of trade. That was not the first time either. And we have a whole litmus of negativity about the AMA that will come up later. So now to the story of the chiropractors, because this is a cautionary tale. We should learn from this, because the same techniques, the same type of scurrilous attacks, the same denigration are alive and well today. They've just morphed into a different persona. The AMA did its best to undercut workmen's compensation programs for chiropractic care, but it was fighting a losing battle on that front, because evidence mounted that for typical industrial injuries, the strains and sprains and wrenched backs typically caused by lifting something too heavy, chiropractic is nearly twice as effective as any treatment by medical physicians measured by the number of days it takes for workers with comparable neck and back injuries to get back to work. During the Chicago trial that I alluded to, the chiropractors relied only on those studies that had been done by medical physicians in order to obviate any argument of bias. There was a famous study done by 1,000 cases in California by Dr. C. Richard Wolf of the California Workmen's Compensation Bureau. Dr. Wolf concluded that while it took 32 days for a medical physician to get the average injured worker back on the job, the chiropractor's average time was 15 days. That's half, less than half, of four comparable injuries, or slightly less than one half. There was also a study done by Oregon Workmen's Compensation Board, Dr. Roland A. Martin, an MD and medical director of the board, found that chiropractors, on average, got twice as many injured workers back on the job within a week as medical doctors. So if you think about it, you'll see why the workmen's compensation boards have been relatively impervious to influence by the AMA. If out of 1,000 workers, 500 of them take 30 days to get back on the job, and 500 of them take 15 days, that adds up to a difference of over 20 years of lost time between the two groups, attributable to half of the patients having been unlucky enough to land in medical physicians' offices rather than the chiropractors. Workmen's compensation boards are under pressure from employees or employers to see that employees get back to work quickly, because the cost of 20 years of workmen's time when those workers are totally non-productive is very high. Moreover, societal losses to the workers' productivity when they're laid up, that's high. Then there is the expense of the insurance provider in paying either the medical physician or the chiropractor. So ultimately, the taxpayers' money is wasted in paying for that extra 20 years of lost time in our sample group of 1,000 injured workers. To millions of Americans, chiropractic adjustments are the only reasonable way of relieving chronic pain. If it were left to the American Medical Association, chiropractic would have ceased to exist many decades ago, back in the 1960s. Claiming chiropractic to be a cult with no scientific validity, the AMA in 1963 formed a special investigative unit which had as its assigned task the isolation and elimination of chiropractic. Now, a plan for this was drawn up by an attorney named Robert Rockthorpe Morton, who worked with the AMA as its general counsel. His plan involved insurance companies and hospitals and state medical licensing boards and public and private colleges and lobbying efforts. Now, as an aside, this is why I'm sharing this with you. If the AMA controls all the licensing, and it does, if the AMA decides what is a legitimate medical therapy and what's going to be covered by insurance, which it has, if the AMA determines what is appropriate protocols to be taught in medical schools, nursing schools, which it also controls, then just imagine the problems are going to emanate if you're the unfortunate person that has something to say about the AMA or orthodox medicine that doesn't align with their beliefs. Let me give you an example of how bad it is. I remember being up at the Fertiller Farm, which was an organic teaching farm upstate in Stone Ridge, New York. This is back in 1971. And as I'm sitting there one day and working on planting, I suddenly have this big gentleman come up to me. And the gentleman said that he must have been about 6'6", 6'7". And he said, Gary Nolan, I said, yes. He said, my name's Robert Vance, and I'm from Utah, and I'm having problems right now with the state medical board. What are your problems? Well, I'm trying to help people get their health by stimulating the immune system using a healthy diet and lifestyle. I said, so? He said, well, they're saying that that's not approved by current scientific standards. And he said, are you aware of other doctors around the country were in similar situations. I said, not at this time, I'm not. So he gave me a list of names, and all the people he gave me were all board-certified physicians, regular standard physicians, nothing unusual there. But what was unusual is they weren't using medical protocols as much as lifestyle intervention protocols. Their reasoning was relatively straightforward. Why not try to correct the person's lifestyle if the lifestyle is what contributed to a person's disease state? That to me is reasonable, but not to the board. And I went to bat for him. I wrote an article about him. I had him on my radio program. And during this whole period, a leading surgeon in his hometown, and they were friends, spoke to me, and he said, He said, I feel like the person that shot an arrow into the back of my friend. And I said, why? He said, well, the state board is talking with everybody that knows him, and if we're not aligned against him, they're going to go after our practices as well. So they threatened you? Yeah. And what'd you do? And he said, well, I acquiesced. I didn't align with my friend. So is there anything in his practice of patient care that you would consider unwise, injurious to the patient? Oh, no. His patients love him. He gets them well quicker than any of us. Is he the only one? Yeah, he's the only one. So the only doctor in your community who gets his patients well without using medicine, though he could, that's the one that you all turn on. And his voice dropped, and he said, yeah, I got to live with it. I says, well, don't feel sorry for yourself. You don't have to live with it. He has to live without having a license to practice medicine. What else is he supposed to do? He's not trained for anything else. He has responsibilities. He has a family. And by the way, that was in Mormon country. So now I find out, I get a call from a woman. Her name was Privateera. And her husband is Dr. James Privateera. And she said, could I help? I said, what was he doing? And right now he's in a chain gang breaking rocks in Southern California. What was his crime? He was found guilty of not using current state medical board standard of practices. Be specific. Well, he would take persons who had been treated elsewhere by physicians, oncologists, radiologists for cancer, and then he spent his time trying to build up their immune systems. And the results, over 270 of his patients came to court to testify on his behalf, and the judge would not allow a single one of them to testify. So how did it come down that he was found guilty? Well, the jury was told that if he was not using current medical accepted practices by the state, then he was guilty of fraud. And so when asked, are you using chemotherapy or radiation or surgery? He honestly said no. That was it. Nothing else had to be said. He was guilty. Dr. Halstead in California suffered the same consequences being attacked. In New York, Robert Atkins. There was Carl Humiston. Humiston was a Harvard grad, wonderful human being. In fact, he was one of the former presidents of his county medical board. He too. In fact, every single doctor in America who ventured to try any alternative therapies was similarly crucified. Dr. Ray Evers down in Cottonwood, Alabama. I flew down to see Ray, and that was a sad day. He's just an old Alabama farmer, nice guy. Patients loved him. He had a holistic clinic, took me through the clinic. But what he was doing for the patients was not relevant. Curing patients was not relevant. Are you using current standard? That's what the public doesn't understand when an organization, which is a union for physicians, the AMA, has more power over how patients are to be treated than the physician. As long as you have to practice medicine in the United States, you must practice under state medical rules, and the AMA controls all this. They control accreditation of medical schools. So if you go against the AMA, they have 100 ways to destroy you, and they've used those. And in fact, the chairman of the board of the AMA, when I wrote a scathing article, the first of its kind, with my co-author, Robert Houston, one of the great investigative journalists in the United States, Robert and I wrote the first nationally published article exposing the corruption in the politics of cancer. It was a sacred cow. Nobody was able to touch that. Well, we did. We showed how absolutely abysmal the whole field was of cancer and how it was self-serving, and they were killing people with chemotherapy and radiation, not helping them in most cases. And they were doing something really vile. If you were a woman with breast cancer and you received any therapy at all, if you didn't die, 100% of the results of your recovery went to the cancer establishment. But what if you changed your diet? What if you changed your lifestyle? What if you were in the South and were outside getting more vitamin D from sunshine? What if you were de-stressed? All these other mitigating circumstances that can involve anti-inflammatory activity and hence the outcome of cancer, those were negated. So the head of the AMA, chairman of the board of the AMA, wrote a letter to me, and he condemned me for this. And so I wrote him back and said, "Sir, I will be happy to debate you in any form that you choose. But now, beyond your anger, show me a single line in my article that is wrong." And there was none. It had been fully vetted, as all my articles are. As a result, that was the last communication I had, but I can assure you that suddenly one more reason to deal with, quote, the null problem, as I would find out. So I give you this as an aside because it was not until we started realizing that there was a systematic campaign in every one of the states to destroy any and all alternative therapy. So even long after the AMA had been stopped, it did not stop the state boards. So we had to go state by state and lobby and get patients to ask for and demand an act to protect the doctor and the patient with informed consent to choose a therapy they felt was in their interest, not dictated by some stupid-ass state board. And by the way, I also saved Stanislaw Brzezinski's career when I got a call. I never met him, didn't know him, that they were on a fishing expedition. I went down to Houston and found out that they were going after him, but they didn't tell him what they were doing. And their own rules show that if you're in there inspecting someone's records, you have to let them know what you're inspecting for, who's made complaints, what the complaints are. They did none of the above. So I exposed them in an article. That article ended up winning two Emmys on 2020. Did another one on 60 Minutes. So I was going after all these people and always behind the scenes, always overseeing everything is the power and influence of the ideology of the AMA, that there can only be one truth, Orthodox medical. Everyone else will be crushed in the process. So that's the reality. Now back to chiropractic, because why chiropractic? Why go after chiropractors? Simple. They represented the second largest and most popular reason for people visiting a doctor. And that was competition. That's simple. So that's where we're at. Now, then you have the Fire of Chiropractors who filed an antitrust suit against the AMA and 10 other medical organizations. The suit went to trial in federal district court in Chicago in late 1980, and the jury found the defendants not guilty. But in 1983, a federal circuit court judge ruled that the case must be retried because there was bias, and the AMA was willing to go to great lengths to carry out its anti-chiropractic campaign. And nowhere is this better illustrated than in its containment of physician studies on chiropractic that were conducted for workmen's compensation boards. Now, this is interesting because the Oregon that I referred to earlier, the Oregon's Workmen's Compensation Board, once scheduled a seminar for all providers of health care to industrial accident victims. These providers included osteopaths, medical physicians, company doctors, and others involved in workmen's compensation programs. A chiropractor was invited to address the group. When the session was first proposed, the Monona County Medical Society and the Oregon State Medical Society, without the knowledge that a chiropractor was to be involved, planned to co-sponsor the meeting in order to help build interest in it. Medical physicians who attended it, they announced, would receive continuing education medical credit towards their license renewal program. But when it became known that a chiropractor was going to address the session, the medical societies immediately withdrew their sponsorship and notified prospective attendees that they would not receive an education credit for attending. In fact, some of the medical panel members then backed out, and the program went forward with a much reduced attendance. What a tragedy that skilled physicians would refuse to listen to another licensed health care provider explain how to treat injured industrial workers when evidence indicated that his profession got markedly superior results in reducing human pain and agony and in reducing the cost of industrial accidents. It's ironic that one of the AMA's major arguments against chiropractic was that chiropractors do not do research in their field. At one time, this was largely true when chiropractic was a profession struggling with limited resources and was not able to support a cadre of researchers. The graduates of chiropractic colleges went out and practiced chiropractic. They relied on clinical results rather than formal research, and the AMA criticized their failures to publish. But in academic parlance, to publish a paper often means to read it to one's peers at a conference, where the work is subject to colleagues' questions and criticisms. Yet in the case of the Oregon seminar, when medical physicians had the opportunity to examine and criticize the ideas of a chiropractor, they decided instead to boycott the session, effectively preventing the chiropractor from sharing his findings. The individual doctors cannot be entirely blamed. They were under terrific pressure from their medical state societies. Another example of the AMA's attempting to sabotage chiropractic education is a manner that was directly damaging to its own membership and their patients is the case of Dr. Philip Weinstein, a California neurologist. Now, Dr. Weinstein had given many lectures to chiropractors on diagnosing illnesses of the spine before he learned of the extent of the AMA's opposition to interprofessional exchanges with chiropractors. He testified at the trial that chiropractors, who often serve as portals of entry to the healthcare delivery system, ought to be better able to recognize several more exotic physical conditions. This would thus allow them to refer their patients to their medical colleagues, thereby benefiting the medical doctors as well as the patients. Seems reasonable. But pressure was brought to bear on Dr. Weinstein, and he canceled his lectures. His letter to a chiropractic group reads, quote, "Please accept my sincerest apologies for this late cancellation due to the circumstances beyond our control. We were unaware that delivering medical lectures to your organization was prohibited." End quote. But the AMA's efforts went far beyond canceling or undermining a few professional seminars. Perhaps the most insidious and indefensible activities exposed at the trial with the efforts of medical groups to prevent chiropractors from expanding or improving their educational base. And while the only issue in the court case was whether or not this was in violation of antitrust statutes, the question for the public is much larger, whether a private organization hindered learning, study, and expression of ideas. In effect, the American Medical Association sought to establish absolute control over the dissemination of medical and health information in the United States. Not good. In its zeal to destroy chiropractic, the AMA had committed itself through Robert Throckmorton's master plan to contain chiropractic schools, quote, "to the extent that the schools Financial problems continue to multiply, and to the extent that the schools are unsuccessful in their recruiting programs, the chiropractic menace of the future will be reduced and possibly eliminated. End quote. Wow. Doesn't that sound like something that Joseph McCarthy would have read? The American AMA maneuvered on many fronts in order that the, quote, the school's financial problems should be continued to multiply. The AMA tried to prevent the government from granting chiropractic students guaranteed student loans. More successfully, it also tried to put a stop to government grants for research and teaching at chiropractic colleges. The AMA also sought to keep chiropractic schools from gaining accredited status, thereby discouraging the better students. And for a long time, chiropractic colleges were accredited only by the chiropractors themselves. There were two accrediting groups, one sponsored by the International Chiropractic Association, representing the straight chiropractors who only offer spinal manipulation, and the other sponsored by the American Chiropractic Association, the mixers, who provide additional modalities of therapy such as nutritional counseling. In the 1960s, the AMA argued that chiropractic education did not meet minimal standards because the two accrediting organizations were not, in turn, accredited by any nationally recognized accrediting agencies, such as the North Central Group or the New York Board of Regents. But at the time, the chiropractic accrediting organizations had not been government certified. The AMA had publicly shed crocodile tears at what it said was the poor state of chiropractic education. Now it went into high gear to see that the status quo didn't change. In every state, it lobbied secretly to oppose the creation of a government-approved accrediting body. The accreditation is a quantum leap forward in status for any school, and the AMA feared that the designation of a nationally accredited body for chiropractic colleges would make it hard to continue to criticize those schools. And it was right. To the credit of the HEW Office of Education, which was made up of educators rather than medical doctors, the AMA's pressure was resisted. The educators' response to the AMA was to insist that their job was to see that the proposed accreditation body met formal standards, not to become mired in a petty conflict between competing health care systems. So in 1974, the HEW, Office of Education, sanctioned the Council on Chiropractic Education as the national accreditation body for chiropractic schools. This had a tremendous impact on improving educational standards at the chiropractic colleges. That was good. Whereas at one time, faculty-student ratio was poor, there were now 129 professors for 1,800 students, for example, at the Palmer College of Chiropractic in Davenport, Iowa. Chiropractors across the United States cooperated in asking legislatures to pass laws that would require 2 years of pre-professional education before students matriculated into a chiropractic college. In other words, a total of 6 years of post-high school education would be required for the Doctor of Chiropractic degree. The chiropractic organizations supported that upgrading of their profession, even though they feared that young people contemplating a chiropractic career, perhaps already intimidated by the AMA attacks, might be reluctant to submit to a 6-year program. The chiropractic groups, nevertheless, took the risk of losing some less highly motivated students because their commitment to serving the public and upgrading their profession demanded the educational standards be elevated. That's important. Also, this is an aside, but very, very significant. We also found documents inside the AMA that were leaked that, and I got a copy, that showed that the AMA had secretly been lobbying every single place you could think of in the government where a doctor would have to be, a medical doctor would have to be on some committee or board. And what was the purpose of this? What was in their literature? It was simple. Let's say that I'll give you a good example of this. Let's say that you're not wanting alternative cancer therapies, and therefore you take the seven doctors who have the best reputations for practicing alternative therapy, like Dr. Lawrence Burton, Dr. Stanislav Brzezinski, Dr. Virginia Livingston Wheeler, Dr. Joseph Issels, Dr. Al-Khaidi. These are just some examples. And without ever interviewing them, without ever interviewing any of their patients, without looking at their background, you simply call them quacks. And then when they suggest a study be done, and you go to different departments, it doesn't matter which department you go to in the federal government or the state government, you're going to have an AMA plant. In effect, an opposition person disguising their bias, but turning thumbs down on every single suggestion it's made. So if you wonder why there's never been a study comparing vaccinated children with unvaccinated children, that's one of the reasons. If you want to know why there's never a condemnation ever by the government or its agency, state or federal, against DDT, DDE, Aldrin, Heptachlor, copper coil 7, asbestos, cigarette smoking, it's not that this information is not available to government scientists and physicians. It absolutely is. All of it. But what is not known to the public is every single office of the government that you go to, there will be an agent representing the medical establishment, historically through the AMA. So remember that. It's just like saying if every cop is corrupt, and I'm not saying that every cop is corrupt, I'm only using this as an example, but let's say you live in a small town and it's a small community, you got 12 cops, and you have a problem, and someone says, go to the police. And if you're not aware, you may go to the police, and what if those police are corrupt? You're in trouble. And that's why some people don't want to go public with some problems, because they don't know the extent to which someone has the power to reach in and stop something. Do you really think that going to the New York Times with a story, an important story, would make a difference? Do you think that it wouldn't be known to the people behind the scenes who could be investigated? They know everything. That deep state is deep, and it's hidden. Only now are they actually showing their hands, foolishly so, because now we know who they are. You know, Brennan, Clapper, we know who they are. So this is how it works. So I just want you to know that you can't just go to a governmental agency and assume that a medical doctor there will be on your side. It doesn't work that way anywhere in America today. Now we go back to learning a lesson about leaning on the universities. I mentioned this at the beginning. The results caught the AMA and the state medical societies by surprise. As state legislatures endorsed pre-professional courses for chiropractors, educational institutions began to make arrangements to offer high-quality undergraduate chiropractic programs. In New York State, CWB Post College, a division of Long Island University, was asked by Indiana's Lincoln College of Chiropractic to cooperate, to establish a pre-professional course, and indicated it would do so. The AMA decided to try to scuttle the program. A doctor on the AMA's Committee on Quackery published a series of articles in the Medical Society newsletter sent to physicians all over New York State. Now, it's not bombast. It's not an exaggeration. The doctors intoned that, quote, the lights of the Empire State have gone out, end quote, because one New York school was contemplating teaching courses in science to chiropractic students. So this AMA plant implored medical physicians to pressure the academic officials at CW Post to drop their plans. The AMA had a lot of ammunition it could bring to bear, since any school with a pre-med program or any other preparatory program for health professionals was to worry about maintaining its friendships with the medical organizations. If a school can't get its, let's say, its pre-med students admitted to medical schools, its program is worthless. The AMA knew that. An example of the pressure tactics used on CW Post appeared in the July 1972 issue of the Journal of the Medical Society of the State of New York. In an article headline, Long Island University says it will not teach pre-chiropractic students, it reported that, quote, the proposal was protested vigorously by the Medical Society of the State of New York in a letter which Medical Society of the State of New York Executive Vice President sent to medical and community leaders and the deans of the state medical schools. Ernest R. Jaffe, acting dean of Albert Einstein School of Medicine of Yeshiva University, also added his disapproval in a letter to Long Island University. Dr. Jaffe said, quote, "I urge you to take all appropriate measures to terminate any relationship with the Lincoln College of Chiropractic. It can only bring discredit to your university," end quote. Sadly, and it is sad, CW Post capitulated to this pressure, terminating all discussions with the chiropractic college. Thus, the medical society succeeded. This conduct strikes at the very foundation on which our healthcare systems, indeed our democratic traditions, are based, and that is education. Have you ever noticed that anyone, I mean anyone, appearing on television, on a panel, or interviewed, they never question their educational background? If a person has a master's degree or an MBA or BS or PhD or an MD, it is never questioned. Unless you offer any alternative perspective, and then they want to make it seem as if your education was out of a Cracker Jack box. So the interview is about why you're not to be respected. You're not to be taken at face value because you're not one of us. It doesn't matter that your academic credentials can be equal or even surpassing other people in the field. They take that minutiae. If you can't attack the results of a person's work, if people are curing people, improving people, and you are not, then attack the person on a level that will make the public fear that this person should never have the responsibility to help you. So they attack their credentials. And then if that doesn't work, they attack, you haven't published, or you're not a scientist, or you're not bird certified. They never do this with each other. Let's just say that you come out in an article and say that you believe that that the radiation from Fukushima, going on for 7 years, is causing health problems in someone in California, and people in California, children in particular, which happens to be true. You'll be immediately challenged. They will not allow you to offer that opinion, no matter what facts you have, but they'll have someone counterbalancing that. That will always be a medical doctor or PhD, and you can bet your life they're going to be affiliated with the utility industries, frequently the nuclear industry. That is never told to the public. If you question vaccines, if you're a medical doctor, board certified in pediatrics, and you have had your own children by your own hand damaged because of the vaccines they were given, then you do your homework, not before. Find out what a fool you were for believing in the false science of vaccinology. You are invited on a show. They will never allow you on that show alone. They will have someone who will come on and challenge you, but they will not show the financial conflicts of interest of the person coming on the show with you. That's how the entire game is worked. I'll give you a good example of this. When someone wanted to do an article on me, and that was fine. I had hundreds of articles written about me. And I knew exactly where this was going. I said, so, you want to see if whether or not what I do works? Well, it just so happens, you're lucky. I'm doing a keynote speech at the Roosevelt Hotel in the Grand Ballroom. There'll be thousands of people there. Come. And the person did. The reporter did. How many people here are medical doctors? Hands went up. Nurses, hands went up. Dietitians, nutritionists, hands went up. I said, how many people here have had diseases? Every hand went up. I said, now, how many of you are better today or reversed your condition based upon protocols that I've shared on my show or in person or in health support groups or in clinical studies? Almost every hand went up. And the guy sitting, it just so happens there was a guy sitting right on the chair right beside this reporter, said, I'd like to talk with you. And I'm 3 feet away, so I'm hearing, he says, I had full-blown AIDS. I was near death. I went to the Tri-State Healing Center, and 2 years later, I not only am completely healthy, I seroconverted to negative. Do you want to hear my story? The person wouldn't talk with him. At the end of that, I turned to the person. I said, let me guess. You're not going to talk with a single person here because the purpose of coming here so you can say you spoke to me, but these are all somehow delusional psychotics who believe that they had a disease that today they don't have, but they probably didn't realize it. And I'll bet you're going to use one of the quackbusters as the so-called expert on what I do. And that's exactly what they did. Exactly what they did. Now, when will you ever hear any of the quackbusters or any of the so-called experts on Wikipedia challenged by us? You will never get a call from the New York Times or the Washington Post or CNN or these other fake organizations. You will never get a call from them saying, we have someone on talking about vaccines. We'd like you to come on and challenge them. You won't have that. It's all pro-establishment. So imagine what it was like to be a chiropractic, so that you're up against a system that had been institutionally biased, keeping you out of educational institutions, keeping you from attending a class where you could advance your education. It's difficult to understand how medical physicians and their trade associations, who have received billions of dollars in public funds for their schools and their services, had the temerity to work to prevent educational improvements for other health professionals. Their concept of medical ethics apparently became so twisted, perverse, disgusting, and degenerate that it no longer had any bearing on patient welfare. In fact, in America today, I dare say that with the exception of emergency medicine, which is exemplary, but it only represents about critical care and emergency medicine, about 12% of medicine, it means 88% is chronic care, and that has failed miserably. And they won't take any credit for their failure, nor do they ever give a refund when they fail, nor do they have the humility to acknowledge they're not these living gods. That's the problem. And yet they stay in total contempt of what they're most ignorant about. Rather ironic. So the chiropractors couldn't work in hospitals, and they couldn't be educated in schools, and so they had a rough go of it until the trial, until those other organizations were found, they were in violation of the law. And because the AMA had total control over the hospitals, and they could de-accredit a hospital. Remember, the primary organization called the Joint Commission on Accreditation of Hospitals, which is sponsored by the AMA, and the American College of Surgeons, and the American College of Physicians, the American Hospital Association, all of which were defendants in the five chiropractic suit, and they all lost, they would keep a chiropractor out. So that's how it worked, until the chiropractors won. So here we are today. I want to give you that history lesson, because medicine and healthcare should be about cooperation, not this intense competition. It should be about helping the patient, preventing disease. We have no preventative program in the United States. Shame on us. We spend more than any other nation in the world this year, over $3.5 trillion, and we'll have the worst outcomes of any developed nation. And yet we insist that we are right about everything when we're wrong about almost everything when it comes to health care. So that's why there are 77,000 chiropractors today, helping 35 million patients. I'm asking those 77,000 chiropractors and 35 million patients to boycott Wikipedia and demand congressional investigations and request the investigative center for the IRS, the Inspector General, to go after them and look carefully. Also, I believe that the skeptic editors and should be shown their biases to the public, and when those biases rise to slander or character assassination or alienation of all alternative and natural health care providers, then they should be held legally responsible. Wasn't it George Santayana who wrote, "Those who do not learn history are doomed to repeat it"? Today we can look at Stephen Barrett, in my opinion, is the current Rock Throckmorton, and Jimmy Wells is the modern-day Doyle Taylor, and Wikipedia as the transformed AMA. So the witch hunt continues. To the multitude of parents with vaccine-injured children and the millions more diagnosed with ADD and ADHD and taking psychiatric medications, this is an important lesson. These power individuals and organizations are permanent. Wikipedia promotes the long-term hegemonic cause of pharmaceutical dominance. They trust the world only as far as they can control it. We need to abrogate our allegiance to them and remain suspicious of their motivations because they are not us. Thank you all for listening. Have a nice day.
Too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find.